What does it mean to you today to have all of this going on in your house and in this music? Because I know you, when we met, I came up and was like, wow, standing amongst your sculptures in a very busy, crazy exhibition. And then I said, I must give you some of my music, but you'd already been sculpting to the music.
Yes, I've been using your music in the background, inspiring me to touch that space.
Yeah.
And when you came up, at first you were this wonderful human being appreciating my work. And then when you brought the music back, I was like,
yeah.
That's you? You're my favorite.
Wow.
But today is a dream come true.
Yeah, me too.
We've been talking about it for a long time.
Yeah.
And it's an experiment.
Yeah.
We both seek to create doorways. And a doorway that lets the love and light of what we are, the beauty of what we are, that bridge to happen so every person can feel it.
Mm.
But most of all, what I find today is an experiment of, and an opportunity more than anything, is that music brings in the celestial spheres, and then there's the task to manifest it in form.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And it's like you and I are creating that total experience through friendship, through sharing, through the two art forms marrying, and also the camera crew.
Yeah.
Thank you very much, because yeah. They've helped to make it
absolutely
visible.
Absolutely, everyone involved.
Yes.
I mean, you can't do anything without someone taking a photo of it.
I just want to say thank you, you know, for opening your home, and I mean, the whole place is a work of art, and you've created like this incredible energy here that. I mean, when I arrived exhausted, I was refreshed by it. And I've only ever experienced that before in, like, retreat places.
Mm-hmm.
Sacred, you know, places in India, sacred places that I've spent time in. But it just shows you that you can put the sacred anywhere as long as your intention is there. So
yes.
You can make your home
a sanctuary.
Space.
Yeah, for sure. Okay. And that's what this house is an experiment of.
Oh, it's so hard to put camera in.
Yeah. Isn't it that? Yeah, that's a great...
We all know that we need water and that we need food. What we don't realize is the importance of beauty within creating harmony in an individual. And it is a bridge. It is the bridge to being a soul in a human experience. It shifts your whole attitude of how you look at the challenges of life. And I think that sometimes my work actually holds on the subtle ground the catharsis of shifting, transforming my pain to a perception of using it for the highest of what I'm here for. Because when I go in the studio, everything's possible for me. I just, all love, all happiness, all transformation. I'm free to create the world that I know that we each can do. There. I know this world can change just if we change our thoughts. And therefore my focus is to do the catharsis with a vision to beauty, or I'm actually on some days there and the imagery is there. And it's like we go from darkness to light was one passage, and now I'm working on light to light.
Okay. Yeah. So your work is a bit is like a mirror then, really.
Yes.
It mirrors back to people.
Yes, hopefully it creates a doorway.
Yeah.
To themselves.
Yeah.
Sweet conversation. simple wish, then lost in connection, lost in the feeling, one for a moment and then torn apart. I'll hold on to you, and maybe, just maybe, a piece of me will make it through. You
said earlier that you hear music when you sculpt.
Mm-hmm.
What does it sound like?
It's a very high frequency. I've often heard about the celestial spheres, that they're singing all the time. And it feels like maybe that's what it is I'm hearing. For me, my artwork, if I'm starting to respond and I'm inspired to create beauty, images of beauty, though, to touch that space when it sings, the clay sings, or the paint sings, and when I feel that, that's when I know that I'm creating images of beauty. And that's my biggest quest, is to create images of beauty. You know, especially in the day and age right now, when we're so attached to CNN images,
you
can forget
to
look at the flower.
Yeah, yes, you can.
Or the rainbow.
Yeah.
That they exist. And actually that's the key to
keep coming back
harmony
to
and joy. We have to keep doing that. And I, as an artist, that's my vision, that's my quest.
I didn't want to sing about pain anymore. I wanted to sing about something that was beyond pain.
Mm-hmm.
Because most pop songs are about, you know, he left me or she left me and now I'm nothing without you. That's quite used a lot. I'm nothing without you. And I wanted to sing about other stuff, things I was looking at in my life.
Mm-hmm. I have a particular technique, if you can call it a technique, that takes a person into their imagination through not finishing a line.
Okay, yeah.
We want to finish the line.
I think I do the equivalent in music with the silences and the spaces, which to me are as important as the words and the sound. So it's kind of a paradox that what makes music powerful is the spaces and the silence.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And I feel that in your work. There's a silence and there's stillness.
No more excuses, gotta reach out your arms and embrace the sun. No more time for self-pitying abuses, gotta stand up and shout and say, I am the one. 'Cause there's been too much crying and talk of being free. You gotta jump off that cliff. Star with your name on it and a love. ice is melting, all the ships are going home. And the wind is getting colder and we feel more and more alone. So stop all your excuses, got the answers all for free. Jump off that cliff and be who you were born to be. Who you were born to be. Sha-la-la-la-la. Sha-la-la-la-la. Sha-la-la-la-la-la. Sha-la-la-la-la. Sha-la-la-la-la. Sha-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la. Jump off that cliff and be. Jump off that cliff and be. Jump off that cliff and be. Who you were born to be.
Lasanda, in what way do you feel your music inspires and touches people?
For me, music has its own life, so you make it, you put your heart into it, I meditate a lot and put my silence into it, and then I let it go. I'm quite detached from it. So I'm not that aware of what it does out there until I get the feedback. And it still surprises me, still touches me that what's going on when it leaves me. But I don't think that's anything to do with me, actually. So I just do what I do and let it go. And I think my awareness comes when I get emails and letters from people who have had some kind of healing or have been profoundly touched by it. And then I'm kind of like, wow.
Can you tell us about your own personal journey that brought you to who you are?
I always sang since I was tiny, and I wrote songs when I was about six. I just started writing songs. It just felt natural to do that. But the journey of this music started when I started to meditate, really. I learned to meditate when I was about 23, 24. And then a different energy started to come in as I began to move away from the pop world and the world of you know, number one hits and videos and all that stuff, and more into a different space where I was just making music without an agenda. And I think actually for the first time started to tell the truth. And that's, I think, when art becomes powerful, when you have the courage to really tell the truth about something, which is bit scary. So my journey, really, in a nutshell, is a journey to get to the truth of things. Who we are, why we're here, what it's all about, how to live your life and be really happy. And the music is almost like a byproduct of that for me. I'm inspired by poets and art. I'm inspired by Ginger and her art. You know, I stood in front of that art in an exhibition and was physically affected by it. So I'm inspired by artists who tell the truth, and they can come from any tradition. I read a lot of Sufi poetry, Khalil Gibran, people like that. I'm inspired by all kinds of music, world music, some buskers, you know, it can be anything. Or even some people who have quirky ways of telling stories. They'll sometimes say a phrase and it will really go in, and I'll just take it. You know, I remember one friend of mine just writing to me saying, oh, your album is like a beautiful storm. And that whole idea of a beautiful storm, I don't know, that things like that, phrases will just get my juices flowing in the creative way. And so it can be, it's the world really, and people, more than, you know, certain artists, musical artists.
You seem to be a happy, fulfilled person. What personal choices have you made in your life journey? Perhaps good and hard that got you to where you are today.
I choose happiness. If you listen to The Mirror, there's a song on The Mirror called Choose, and it really is about when you open your eyes in the morning, you have a split second to catch yourself before the feelings kick in. Because sometimes you can wake up with a cloud, and we all do, and other days you can wake up with a good feeling. But there's a split second when the mind wakes up that you get to make a choice about your day. And I do that. I lie there and I make a choice. How do you want to play today? You want to create lightness? You want to create beauty? Do you want to look at something and be appreciative? Or do you want to go, another day? You know, it comes down to this moment by moment choice. And that is about, for me, getting to know your own mind. Listening to the mind and what it's doing, because the mind is like this crazy horse out of control. Until we get hold of the reins again and go, hang on a minute, am I going to go down this spiral of negativity or moaning, or am I going to start to make little changes? Like when I catch my mind doing this, I'll look at something like that and go, wow, look at that flower, let me lift my energy again, let me, and then the thoughts start to spiral up again and it's easier. So for me, it's choices, minute by minute choices it comes to. And that creates happiness. Happiness takes practice. It's like everything. You know, you see a beautiful ballerina, they didn't do that overnight. They rehearsed for many, many hours in the dark, and they practiced, their feet bled. And then they come out and it looks like the most stunningly beautiful thing. But it comes with practice, and happiness for me is the same. I mean, it's always there. To me, when there's crisis and craziness going on, if you sit for long enough, you'll always come back to peace. And for me, peace is the foundation on which you can build happiness.
And that's how it's going to be.
I have come. have written lines in my part. Only for you, only for you. I have saved a space in my heart. I have carved your name on my star. I have written lines in my part. Only for you, only for you.
For you, can you tell us about that?
Well, the mirror is, yeah, it's a different phase. I think you go through different phases of your life, and you know, whether you're a writer or a singer or a sculptor, you make art from whatever you're going through. And there were some big changes between the material I produce with Bliss to the material of the mirror. And there's a different energy, definitely. I've come out of a very yogi way of life, very much part of a community, and come back more into the world. And I think you can feel that energy in the album. And also just a new understanding of what spirituality is in everyday life, really learning to just take each moment and live the things I've learned in the past 13 years with my meditation practice to bring it into daily life, because what happened was everything broke down, and of course all your biggest fears have been manifested. All the things you were frightened of, losing your partner, your community, your structures that held all your masks in place and all your roles in place, they all fell apart. And so the mirror is when I look in the mirror of me, am I really prepared to see what's there? And in order for me to survive as a human being, I had to do that. To go through the process of breakdown that I went through, I had to really look in the mirror and be prepared to make the changes that needed to be made.
Cheers. By a stream where the sun sits on the water, you can learn to stop thinking without falling asleep. Falling asleep. Cause I'm tired of running in circles, and I'm tired of chasing my tail. Gonna sit right here. Sit right here. Gonna watch the sunset. Gonna watch the butterflies. Gonna watch the leaves change. Gonna watch my washing dry. Gonna sit right here. Gonna sit right. No need to try. All you ever know is love is coming through you. Yeah, yeah. I'm tired of running in circles, and I'm tired of chasing my tail. clouds go by. Gonna watch the leaves change. Gonna watch the swallows fly. Gonna sit right here. Gonna sit right here.
Silence. I'm coming from a place of connection with the source, whatever you want to call that. And so I'm just trying to get out the way as much as possible and bring it through. So hopefully it has maybe a universality about it that people can connect with. That's why I think I'm detached, can be detached from it, because I bring it through, but it's not mine. Maybe that makes it unique, I don't know.
For any budding songwriters or singers out there, what advice would you give them, Lucinda?
I wouldn't give any advice on music, because I do believe everybody has a different music in them, and you know, what one person likes another person doesn't like. So that's a very personal thing. So I wouldn't advise them on their music. I would just say, if you want to be a powerful artist, then you have to do the work on yourself and learn to tell the truth about what's really going on in you and what you observe. I mean, some of the most powerful things are so simple. You hear some of the Tom Waits songs when he just sings it as it is. I don't know, there's a power in that. There's a power in naivety sometimes. To be yourself is probably the best advice I'd give. And that's a journey.
Faces and open doors, when everyone else seems so serene, and I just feel so insecure. And where do I go when all the pieces of my heart lay on the floor? You say, come into the light, why don't you? Come into the light, why don't you? Come on now, come into the light. Where do I go with all these memories and all these bags filled up with shame? And how should I feel when you call me an angel? Into the light. What should I do when a gentle hand it reaches out to take my own? And how should I feel when tears of joy they just won't stay inside these eyes? And what will I do when I start to love you and really try? trust and know you're there, you say. You'll be in the light where I am. You'll be in the light where I am. Come on now, come into the light. Come into the light, why don't you? Come into the light, why don't you? Come on now, come into the light.
Has the ability to break down barriers?
Completely, because it goes across age, it goes across race, culture. It's like when you can fuse different cultural, different music from different cultures, it works. You know, you can bring African beats and put it with Chinese harmony and it works. It's like for me, it is completely a breaker of boundaries. I love that. I love that about it. I love the fact that you can go that at one of my concerts there can be somebody in their 80s and a 7-year-old who get it. I've sung in primary schools to a sea of 5-year-olds and seen the faces of like a 6-year-old really get some of the music and for a moment become really internal and really reflective. And you think, wow, what's going on in that being? You know, they're so deep already at that age. So I think music does that in so many ways. I love singing in India because they really know how to do joy in India. They do. They celebrate everything. You buy a new car, it gets decorated and spray painted and, you know, a ritual is performed to welcome it into the family. And so when I've sung in India, just the joy, you know, it's just, so they always give a lot back because they really know how to celebrate everything. So music is just another one of those things that they can do that for. But every culture is different. Every culture is, Iceland was interesting because I felt, because the music provokes a lot of deep feelings and goes deep, that it was tapping into a really deep underlying sadness there, and I actually cut the concert a little bit short because I felt it was getting too intense, actually. So that was interesting. And I love singing in America because they're so open-hearted and they just, you know, things like.
I got to get Lucinda's guitar that I changed the strings on last night and set it up for her, perhaps tune it for her. This is on camera so that she knows what I do behind the scenes for her.
let you go.
You to stand in, what would you do in your shift?
For me, God is a being who just shines like the sun. It just gives. It's an energy or a point of consciousness or whatever you want to label it that just beams out love and energy and goodness. And so I don't think I would do anything differently. Because then everybody gets to make a choice about how they use that. There's no force, there's no imposing on anybody. So it's perfect. So I don't think I'd do anything differently than that. But maybe I wouldn't quite match up to the power of that source.
Why did you choose this location for this interview and for this concert?
Well, initially I wanted to just film a live concert. But I personally find it, watching live music on a DVD can sometimes be a bit dull. And I was worried that we wouldn't capture what I do live because it is quite subtle. And when I came across Ginger's art, I felt the same energy in her work that I feel when I sing. It affects me in that way. So I always had this dream about singing in amongst her beautiful, huge sculptures. I always saw Wembley Stadium, actually. but when she showed me pictures of her house, I mean, you know, it was just so great to be here with them. So when she said, why don't you film at my house, I just jumped at the opportunity and it became something different. It's the meeting of the two art forms, you know, the sonic and the visual, and hopefully that will add to the feeling that we create here today.
like